that. And Dad had this old tube of radio with these great big ugly batteries and aerial that ran way off into the bush somewhere. And the CKBI Prince Albert and CBC, Waters at that time. And that was basically our window on the world. 5:30, we listened to the Northern News on CKBI, find out what everybody was doing in hospital and this kind of stuff, northern communities, and then at 6 o'clock we had the CBC News. And even back then, I was just a tad bit, but I can remember James M. Minifee giving reports, and I used to wonder where he was at and where he is at this exotic time and what he was doing and stuff like this. So when I heard that I was going to give a Minifee lecture, I was really quite happy to do it, because it took me way back to when I was just young. And I didn't realize at the time, but listening to the radio and becoming a news junkie, my future passion would become journalism. I was telling these guys, I'm going to do this. I'm going to wander way off my script and get lost. So just work with me here. And just a little bit on my background as a journalist. I've done columns. I worked at the Alberta Native Communication Society. That was my very first job. I was on the student newspapers at Simon Fraser and Mont-Royal College as well. But I also did a column for the Edmonton Journal at one time. Then I moved back to Saskatchewan, where I was with the Saskatchewan the Federation of Saskatchewan Indians. We had a newspaper called the Saskatchewan Indian, and I wrote that. And I regarded print journalism as the purest form of the art, and I looked down on anybody who was in anything else until I got into the documentaries and filmmaking. And then I discovered you could layer your product. You could add pictures and music and graphics and special effects, and you could put it all together and make a really beautiful production if you had the right people working with you. And so then I moved into that. And on my reserve we have a big hill, it's called the Blue Hill. So I named my company the Blue Hill Productions. And people had told me, don't give it an Indian name, because no white people will buy from you. So I said, well, no one's going to know what a Blue Hill is. So I went with Blue Hill. Anyway, about 1991, Trevor Suter, Trevor. Anyway, he was a reporter with the Regina Leader Post, and he had what they call the Indian Beat. And he put together a group of us as writers to do a column. And he picked one of us every week and we'd write to do a column. And there were about five or six of us. And I'd say in the space of 2 months, it just all boiled down, and I was the residue that was left. Everybody else quit, or they had a few good rants in them, and then they had nothing more. And so I ended up as a writer, sending in a regular contribution, and that's basically how I got started doing newspaper columns. And like was mentioned, I've done them for 25 years, 50 columns a year, that's 1,250 columns. So at the time I thought, there's no way I'm going to be able to do this every week. I just can't think of anything. And sometimes now, I will have three or four topics that are there for me to cover. There's so much happening. It's just all taken off. There's been a renaissance, but that's not the word I'm looking for. There's been a real growth in the Indian country out there. The population has gone up. The education level's gone up. So many things have changed and happened in the 25 years since I began this. But I think what you have to do is you have to look back and look forward. And that's the topic I'd like to explore tonight. When we look back, we look at where we are today and things that happened, they just didn't happen overnight. The good things and the bad things. It took many years of hard work, or many years of destructive work to get where we are today. And so when you look at an issue, you have to dissect it and look back into the history and say, what happened, where did we go wrong, and what could be done. So when you look at the daily media, you get a chronicle of events that happened, you get one story, and it's sitting there in isolation. There may be a little bit of background in it, But basically, the story is sitting there in isolation. And if you don't know, if you just came here from another country, or if you don't know Indian issues, you will not be able to put it in any kind of context. So let me just explain that. So you have to sort of step back and take a wide look at the landscape. And back in 1900, there were 11,000 status Indians here in Saskatchewan, and about 100,000 for the entire country. Now, and that would drop even further with the flu epidemic of 1917. And we were considered a people who had no place in the future. And that's obvious when you look at government records and what was done to us. There was no future. The kids were taken, put in boarding schools. Adults were ignored, and we weren't given any chance to develop as a people. Now, after the Second World War, we had the improved public health, antibiotics, and so on, and the population began to grow. Now, when I came back I went to the University in Vancouver, by the way. When I came back here in 1970, we had a population of about 36,000 Indian people here in Saskatchewan. And that was one of the highest in the country. And we still have one of the highest in the country in this province. But that was 36,000, and we had a population of around about a million in this province. So today, that population has grown over 130,000 people, status Indians in Saskatchewan. And the population is a little over a million, gone up a bit, but not that much. So you can see we're the fastest growing group in the country. The day will come when we will probably level up around about, we're about 15% now. We'll level out around about 25%, I imagine. And so we have some areas where inner city schools, for example, you had anywhere from 90 to 100% Indian students going to those schools. In the rural areas, you have shrinking rural towns, but you've got growing reserves. We're going to actually have reserve communities that are bigger than the surrounding town. The town was once known as an Indian town, it'll be the other way around, you know. We're going to have more people living on the reserves. And one of my favorite comedians was Charlie Hill from the United States. He used to say, they call us a vanishing race. When's the last time you saw a pilgrim? Now, shortly after I got started out here, in 1972, there began a process called Indian Control of Indian Education. And this was a national policy document that was developed by the National Indian Brotherhood, which was a forerunner for the Assembly of First Nations. And the policy of Indian Control of Indian Education meant that we wanted schools unreserved, we wanted institutions, and we wanted to take control of our own education. And that was, for the next decade, that was the driving force out there in Indian country. And the result was we had the Saskatchewan Indian Community College, which became the Saskatchewan Indian Institute for Technologies. We had the Saskatchewan Indian Federated College, which became the First Nations University of Canada. And then we had schools all over the province develop on reserves. And it's amazing, the population, because we're growing so fast, about half our population is under the age of 20. So that means half our people are still getting education, they're going to be looking for their first job, and there's a lot of pressure on reserve communities. There was one reserve, and they had a kindergarten population of 100. They had 100 kids in kindergarten. So you can see how fast some of these communities are growing, and the pressure that's on us to respond and to do things. Now, when I went to my university, our role models were basically teachers and social workers and people who went into the Army and the RCMP members, because these were the people that were in our communities. These were the ones that we dealt with on a regular basis, and looked to them and we said, I want to be like that guy, you know. So when I went to university, I went to be a teacher, which lasted about a year when I discovered you had to actually teach kids. Forget that. And I never imagined in my wildest days, even though I worked on a student newspaper, I never imagined that I would become a journalist or a filmmaker. Because those kind of people just didn't exist in our community. It was more than I could expect in our life. So anyway, the other interesting product of this policy of Indian control of Indian education has been the liberation of Indian women. And I think this is one of the things that's one of those major turning points in our society, because two-thirds of the students attending post-secondary right now are women, and three-quarters of the graduates are women, so they're even doing better. And they're forming the basics of the professions. We have National Indian Nurses Association, or I believe they have a different name now. We have the First Nations lawyers. We have teachers. We have people in medicine. And the majority of academics and PhD are women as well. So we're developing not only a sense of our own power, but we also have now a sense of community, a professional community. I'd just like to add that a couple of weeks ago we did a conference on reconciliation in the media up in Saskatoon. And for the first time, in my career, I actually felt a sense of community, because I was surrounded by all these journalists, Native journalists from across the province. And we were all working together for a common cause. It's the first time I'd ever felt that, because we all worked together. We worked separately in our newsrooms or in our own businesses or whatever. So it's, we're getting more and more, we're getting into the mainstream, but we're getting into the mainstream on our own terms, if I can put it that way. Now, to look at the passage of time, our elders tell us we must draw upon our inheritance and use that to decide our way of the future. The Haudenosaunee, who are also known as the Six Nations, stress the importance of the long view. Now, Rick Hill Sr., who's a Tuscarora leader in the Six Nations, put it this way, and I'll quote, "We're connected to the first Indians who walked on this earth, the very first ones, however long ago that was. But we're also connected to those Indians who aren't even born yet, who are going to walk this earth. And our job in the middle is to bridge that gap. You take the inheritance from the past, you add to it your ideas and your thinking, you bundle it up and shoot it to the future. And there's a different kind of responsibility. That is not just about me, my pride, my ego. It's about that other stuff. We inherit a duty, we inherit a responsibility." And that is, in a nutshell, how Indian people, in a traditional sense, will see their role as bridging the past and the future. And so that's why so many things, when we negotiate, when we look at issues and stuff, we don't have the same sense of urgency, we don't have the same, we have a longer view of it. We know we're gonna win. We will win, I know that for a fact. But it's just gonna take longer, and it's gonna be done in our way, and it's gonna be done in a peaceful way too. That's the important thing. So it's kind of comparing the historical arc of Canada's First Peoples is kind of like comparing it with a discussion on global warming. You can talk about the weather, you can talk about the climate. Well, it's the same thing with us. You talk about what's happening day to day, and then you talk about the long-term trends. And then you can really see the full picture. So what we have is Haudenosaunee believe that one has to look back seven generations in the past and seven more in the future when you're making important decisions. And that's way different from what governments do, city councils or provinces or whatnot. They just look at the here and the now and what we have to do. The traditional Indian view, traditional First Nations view, is to take a look at the past and the future and look at and do the best for those people who aren't even born yet. Now, we live in a 24-hour news cycle. Politicians live from day to day. A four-year election window and a campaign that never ends. Bureaucrats have a fiscal year. And the world plays a very short game, while First Nations have traditionally played a very long game. And we have the expression Indian time. And that's why I told these guys here, let's wait half hour, because maybe more Indians will show up. that's what happens. You call a meeting on the reserve for 7:30, and by 8 o'clock, you've got a full hall. And I was telling them the way to get around it is to serve supper, and then everybody's there on time. But anyway, we have this thing called we're half hour behind the rest. And I was just thinking, when I was down in Jamaica, they were talking about island time, and I knew exactly what they were talking about. It's the same thing. So because of this, because of our view of time, our leaders have frustrated legislators because they have a different agenda, requiring different deadlines, and pressure them on to complete a deal is not as urgent at the same time frame, because we know we're going to get what we want if we just wait long enough. In fact, there was a professor one time who studied Indian people. He was an anthropologist at the University of Chicago, and I can't remember his name, that's why I didn't write it down. But when he was doing his dissertation for his PhD, one of the people asked what he learned. What is his sort of overall thought about Indian people? And the guy scratched his head and he says, "Well, I think they're just waiting for us to leave." And that's kind of it. Now, well, the Indian Act put us on a 2-year election cycle, which was absolutely ridiculous. You'd get a council elected, they spend 1 year trying to figure out what they were going to do, and the next year the next election. So it was a recipe for disaster. So now there are clauses in the Indian Act you can take on your own band custom rules, and a lot of the bands have adopted that. My reserve for one is one. We go to 4-year terms, and it's much more doable. And it's quite interesting when you talk about traditional First Nations governments. They were nothing like we have today. They were very, very tribal. You would have a person, generally a man, as far as I know, it was a man. I'll stick my neck out. And he would gather followers around him. And because he had leadership abilities, he'd bring in relatives, he'd bring in friends, and his group would grow. And so some of the larger bands had really great leaders. I look at Attakapu, Mistawasis, Yellow Quill. Some of these had large groups of people, and they were excellent leaders, and they gathered people around them. And you can't do that anymore, because let's say you found a good leader, people can't leave the reserve. They can't all move over to another reserve. You have to stay where you're at. So we're stuck in a world we never made, and we have to work within this new restricted framework. At one time we used to have lifetime chiefs. A chief would be appointed to life, and my reserve, the Little Pine Reserve, had one of the last lifetime chiefs in this province. Chief Blackman was asked by his people to lead them in 1915, and he remained in office until his death in 1956. So there was a long stretch, and I know other leaders. Chief Alan Hennecue, for example, was a chief for over 40 years. Other people who were chiefs for a lifetime, and because it was so much different back then. And well, elected government may sound so democratic, but it's when it's forced on people, when it comes from the top down, it doesn't work. The community has to develop their own systems and work up, and that's been the that's what colonialism does to people. Colonialism is something imposed on top of you, whereas by doing it ourselves, we chart our own course. Now, the relationship between our First Nations in Canada and Saskatchewan is based on treaty. Saskatchewan is built on treaties 4, 5, 6, and 10, and these treaties allow the land to be open for settlement and railroad access. Now that's where it kind of differed. The Canadian government saw the treaties as paperwork. Let's get possession of this land and get on with what we're going to do. On the other hand, the First Nations saw the treaties as a way of the future. They believed when the Queen's representatives stated that they would share the land and work together. And we were promised education, social services, and so on. But those treaties were signed in the 1870s, and we were suffering from disease, starvation. The Cree and the Blackfoot had just concluded wars, and so there was a loss of life and economic effects that war brings to a people. The interesting thing that a lot of people don't realize is that the war between the Cree and the Blackfoot was worked out amongst ourselves. There was no colonial interference whatsoever. The Cree and the Blackfoot got together at the town, well, the town is the Peace Hills, as Wetaskiwin it is today, and they made a peace treaty. They smoked the pipe. They agreed to not fight again. The Red Deer River became the boundary between the two groups. And according to my dad, because my great-grandfather was there at the time, our oral history is that they lined up all the Cree warriors on one side, all the Blackfoot on the other, and it was about a kilometer or more long, all these horsemen, and they gave the war whoop and they ran toward each other's top speed, and they stopped and they made peace, they shook hands. And that way the peace was made with the chiefs on one level, but was also made with the warriors on another level. And so that peace held. So when it came to us making treaty, we had that experience. We knew what a treaty was. We knew what peacemaking was. And we knew what keeping your word meant. And so that's why it seems there's sort of two mindsets about treaty. One is that it was something that existed in the past, but in our people's minds, it's something that's very much alive and a living document. Now, there's a lot of things that happened during that period. The reserves were established, and the formula was that you would have a section of land for a family of five. Or if you divide 640 acres by five, you get 127 acres. So there was that much land per person. And surveyors came out to survey the land and determine the size of the reserves based on the head count. And as a result, a lot of the reserves were quite small. And they were quite a bit smaller than they should have been. The idea of a section of land for a family of five was sort of based on two things. One, that was a standard European or Canadian-sized farm at the time. And the second was that population was not supposed to grow. Because, the population grew, the land would divide up smaller and smaller. So it didn't really work. And the thing is, our people did take to it. They broke the land with walking plows, they began to get herds of cattle, plant gardens, and they started to develop self-sufficiency. In fact, it was so good that they actually went into town and were selling at the local town. And some of the local farmers complained to the Member of Parliament, and members of Parliament complained to their government, of course, and there were clauses put in the Indian Act that no Indian person could sell farm produce without the say-so of without a permit from the Indian agent. And of course, the Indian agent wouldn't give one out, or if he did, it was only the favorites. So where we could have had an agricultural economy, it slid backwards to a subsistence economy. And that's sort of where we stayed for generations. And we were stuck. There was an Indian agent in North Battleford named Peter Reed. He was called Ironheart by the local people because his heart was made of iron, they said. And he would not give out the rations, give out help, assistance to people. And he had this silly idea that our people had to, he believed in social Darwinism, our people had to grow. So, well, the local settlers were arriving with mechanized farm equipment. Our people were using shovels and hoes and sickles and harvested with flails. So there was no way we could have possibly competed and grown an agricultural economy using stuff from the Middle Ages. So one area where they didn't interfere was in the sale of horses. And Indian people were excellent equestrians. We lived on the plains, we traveled with the horse. Horse was a very important part of our culture. In fact, the culture of the plains was known as the horse culture at that time. And so what they did was, the people would breed horses, they'd break them and train them either for saddle horses or draft horses, and then they'd sell them. And the problem was, of course, you can only sell so many horses. And then that farmer's got enough horses to kind of sustain the yield and breed his own. So it was a short-lived kind of era, period. But nevertheless, people around my area, they had lived in the Manitou Lake area, made a lot of money selling horses to settlers. Just break here and tell you a little story. There was a guy, we had a horse that had a type of epilepsy. The horse was a beautiful looking horse. He'd walk around and then he'd faint. And anyway, he sold him to a Frenchman, a French settler. And the Frenchman, you know, took the horse and went away, and the horse faded. He came back, and of course he couldn't find the guy split. And so he took the name, in Cree, he was given the name French Cheater. That was his name, he was the French Cheater. And then some stupid guy in the Department of Indian Affairs spelt it wrong, and it came out as French Eater, which didn't make any sense at all. And this is one more story of something happened that we had nothing to say over. Our people are quite good at breeding horses and selling them and this type of thing. Now, if I could just back up a little bit here, because it's quite interesting that Chief Little Pine, did not sign a treaty at Fort Carlton or Fort Pitt in 1876, but he held out for a better deal, and he signed a treaty in 1879 in Fort Welsh, in the Cypress Hills. And he and Chief Piapot and Chief Big Bear and some others would not leave the hills. They stayed there for 2 years. They were starved out, quite literally starved out, by the federal government. The federal government did not want any Indian reserves south of the CPR main line, and that was clear. And so Little Pine and others refused to go north, and they had land for us up at the Battle River, and we refused to go. But in his book, Clearing the Plains, Jim Daschuk, he describes this, and I quote, "On March 1882, the Prime Minister announced to Parliament that all the Indians in the territory of Assiniboia would be removed by force, if necessary, from the land south of the proposed railway. Within a year, 5,000 people were expelled from the Cypress Hills. In doing so, the government accomplished the ethnic cleansing of southwestern Saskatchewan's indigenous population." So there was only one small reserve that remained in the hills, and this was Nikadit. And their story is quite interesting because Nikadit was a headman to Chief Kakawistau, who lived in the Coppell Valley. And one time he had a dream after the hills were cleaned out. He had a dream and some spirit came to him and said, "You have to go back to the hills. There's nobody there. Our people need to be there." So he took some followers and he traveled all the way back to the Cypress Hills and they set up a camp. And they kept moving around in the hills. RCMP and people tried to chase them out, but they couldn't do it. So they just left them alone and ignored them. And the thing was, I was part of the work, I did work in the treaty land entitlement area, and when it came to Nikadit, they didn't know what to call it. This is the Indian Affairs branch, because they always have names for everybody. So Nikadit became known as a historical curiosity, because he didn't fit their mold. So anyway, they got their land and so on and so forth eventually. Now, when the people went north, things didn't get much better up in the Battlefords area. We were supposed to have a reserve somewhere south between Lloydminster and the Maidstone, somewhere in that area, there was a piece of land set up, and Little Pine would not stay there. He said, miles from nowhere. And they moved over beside Chief Poundmaker, and they stayed and camped there. And so they came and surveyed the reserve, and they made it small because, well, he was stubborn and they wanted to teach him a lesson. And anyway, the winter of 1884-85 was very, very rough. And there was no rations, there was hardly any game. People were starving, and they went in the spring of 85. They went into Battleford, town of Battleford, to meet with the Department of Indian Affairs. And when the Indian agents saw them coming, the word was that they were on the warpath. Someone had said they were coming to get you. And so he ran to the fort and took all the townspeople with him, and everybody hid in the fort. And the chiefs couldn't control the young men, the warriors, and they broke into the stores and started helping themselves. Meanwhile, they had a gun in the fort, and this gun kept firing, and never could reach the town of Battleford. I don't know if you're familiar, but the town of Battleford isn't where it is today. It was down by the river, the Battle River, as it goes through It's to the north and, no, south and west of the fort. But it was still without, it wasn't within range of the cannon. And so they were down there in that little place, and they looted the place. My grandfather was there, and according to my dad, he filled his pockets with candy. And anyway, the long and short of it is, we had the battle at Cut Knife Hill. Warriors were killed. Little Pines warriors were battle hardened because we fought the Blackfoot, and we played a major role in the Battle of Cut Knife Hill. The Canadian militia, a bunch of farm boys from Ontario, were green, hadn't had any experience, very little experience in battle, and they retreated. And at the same time, our people were running out of ammunition. If they had known that, it could have been a little bit different, but they didn't. Anyway, it was a minor victory in the history for our side. Now, there were so many people that went to Stony Mountain Penitentiary, they had to build a new wing. There were 19 Métis and 33 First Nations warriors convicted of various offenses, and 8 of them were found guilty of capital offenses, and they were hung in Battleford. The largest public hanging in the history of Canada. The children from the same Battleford's industrial school were forced to witness it, and at that time, Thunderchild and Busiman reserves were out close to where the town of Delmas is, and they were brought in to see this. By the way, the magistrate in charge was a man named Charles Rollo, and his namesake is the town of Rollo, otherwise known as Dog River. And the government asked Hayter Reap, the Indian agent again, to identify rebel bands, and he did. He identified 14, and these 14 bands went for years without any annuities, any assistance. They weren't allowed to have a chief of council, and some of them, it took 30 years for Little Pine to get a leader again. Beardy's was the longest. They couldn't get a chief until 1936. So there was a real gap here. And the interesting thing is, Beardy's has since taken this matter to court, and they now have not a court, it's a tribunal, and they now have a ruling in their favor, and all of the bands, including ours, my band, are going to be getting some kind of compensation for this loss of our political rights. Now, one of the interesting things about this period is that journalism was just in its infancy back then. And editorial policies, basically, just the guy who owned the printing press, they could be openly racist, very conservative, and very political. And objective journalism was nothing but a distant dream. And one of the first, the first newspaper in the province was the Saskatchewan Herald, which was published in Battleford. I keep saying North Battleford when I was there. Anyway, and its editorial policy was typical for the day. It began publishing in 1878 and ceased publication in 1930. William Gamey Laurie was the editor. He came from Eastern Canada, and he brought with him his whole editorial society was blatantly pro-conservative. He advocated only English and German settlers coming to the West. He didn't want Eastern Europeans. He didn't want people of color. He considered Indians to be an obstacle to settlement. And because of his advocacy, he ensured that only white Anglo-Saxon settlers were welcome in the sounding around the area. He's the one who incorrectly or erroneously stated that the Cree and the Nakota in the area were followers of Riel and on the warpath. And he never forgave us for the siege of Battleford, the so-called siege, and subsequent looting, and he raised every possible opportunity. So his influence brought long-term effects to the Battleford area. One person can poison a whole community. One person can do something great and help a whole community for the future. But in the case of this, we have problems today in North Battleford, and they've had problems in the past. I remember at one time they were trying to set up a loitering bylaw in the town of North Battleford, and it was obviously aimed at Indian people who stood around on street corners visiting each other. That's loitering, it's against the law. And other things like that. And so it became a, if you look back and you say, oh, say somebody's great grandfather read this newspaper and passed the information on to his son, who passed the information on to his daughter, who passed information on down the line, you get a residue of thinking that's woven right into the culture of that community. And they don't even know where it came from. It goes back to the poison thinking of this man. And this kind of vocal support gave the government license to force draconian control over First Nations across the plains. Because he wasn't alone. There were lots of other people who were advocating things like this. When I was doing a documentary on boarding schools, and I was researching the fire at the Del Mas boarding school. This boarding school burnt, and it was in 1946 or something like that. It was relatively recent compared to some of the other ones. But there's only a two-paragraph article in the newspaper, and it's just kind of glib about how are they going to feed all these Indian kids. And that's it. It was a major disaster, you know, and it didn't raid any ink at all in the grand scheme of things. Anyway, going on with the early journalism in this province, Clifford Sifton was the Minister of the Interior, which included the Department of Indian Affairs. And he was in the Laurier government, and he was a real booster of Western immigration. There's a book called The Last Best West, and that's what he did. He advocated for this last best West, and people would have to come out here, and they'd just throw seeds on the ground, and stuff would spring up. It was he really sold it. And by the turn of the century, big chunks of Saskatchewan, Alberta, Manitoba had filled up. It had been successful beyond his wildest dreams. But there were still people wanting to come. So then Sifton purchased the Winnipeg Free Press, the Regina Leader Post, no, it's called the Regina Leader back then, and the Saskatoon Star Phoenix. And he used that as a, you know, to publicize his ideas and this type of thing. And we researched this, so I'm not telling you a lie. He was inside the Department of Indian Affairs, and there was an open policy to have as much land transferred to, you know, surrendered as possible. And so over the next 20 years, 30 years even, they kept putting pressure on reserves, to bands to sell their reserve land. And in the south here, a lot of the reserves were reduced by about half, because they were forced to sell their land for settlement. Paiapot, for example, about half their land was taken, for soldier settlement after the First World War. They offered the soldiers land, and they just took it from the Paiapot Reserve. And other reserves, I think Muscat Lake lost their land the same way. So there was an enormous amount of land that was lost across Saskatchewan. Now, so if you take these two things, you got the, first of all, a lot of reserves were shorted to begin with. They weren't given proper land, and a whole bunch more had lost half their land. So we had an enormous amount of land claims and treaty land entitlement to work through. And we had, in the FSIM when I was there, there was a treaty rights and research department, and we began the process of researching each individual land and how much was lost and how much was shorted, this type of thing. Also, at this time, it's quite interesting, the churches took over the former government-owned industrial schools. At the time, we had what we called Indian industrial schools, the forerunner of the boarding schools, and they were operated by the federal government. And this was a practice that began in Quebec. After the fall of Quebec, after the fall of Quebec and the British took over, the elites in Quebec all left. They went back to France, or they went to another college. That was all the teachers, the lawyers, the professional class, all these kind of people. And they left, basically, the farmers, laborers, and fur traders were what remained in Quebec. And so rather than administer it to bring in, you know, it was a lot of work for the British colonials, they turned it over to the church. So the Catholic Church ran Quebec for about, I don't know, quite a few years, up until quite a revolution in the 1960s. And so they had this experience, And so they used the same practice with us. They turned education, social responsibility, and things like this over to the churches. And that's basically how they were able to turn around and walk away and renege some of their practices. Talking about social services, my dad told me a story. Chief Big Bear had a daughter, her name was Earth Woman. She lived on Little Pine, and the church gave her what they called a begging letter. She was given this letter, and on it read, this is on behalf of so-and-so, she's destitute, can you please help her with some clothing or food or something like that? And so she would go into town, and she couldn't speak English. She'd show people this letter, and they'd give her stuff, give her something. Maybe, sometimes they wouldn't. And this is how she survived. Until one day, she was in the town of Unity, and she collapsed on the street and died. And that was their church's idea of social services back then. And according to my dad, there was an enormous outcry from the local people and saying the Indian Affairs has got to take better care of the people. So, you know, this is how bad things have really got. We were just depending on the charity of others. And so anyway, I'm kind of lost here again. I'll tell you about treaty land entitlement because that's something I was involved in. I was with the FSIN, that was one of my portfolios, and in 1976, after years of negotiations, they developed what was called the 76 formula. And on the surface, it sounded pretty good. You got, they took the population as of the end of 1976, multiplied it by 127 acres per person, less the amount of land you'd already received. And so some bands got quite a bit of land, 30, 40, 50,000 acres of land. The only problem was, and this was the poison pill, only Crown land was available for selection. So that way you got community pastures, you got the PFRA pastures, you got the land nobody else wanted. It was land that ranchers were using for their cattle grazing, that's all it was. And it really went nowhere. There was only a small amount of land transferred. The Prince Albert student residence was transferred to the school, pardon me, the Peter Ballantyne band got the Prince Albert student residence land. And then the news media kind of stepped in again. And the media loves to generalize. Tell Houston students, don't generalize. they would say, the 76 formula gave 1 million acres of land to Indian people, and it did. It was being settled. It was 1 million acres of land that could have gone to Indian people, all being Crown land, of course. But if you start to stop and take a look at Saskatchewan, here's a land mass that's 2 times the size of France. And if you look in the middle of the province, you'll see a little square, and that's the Prince Albert National Park. And that's 1 million acres of land. So that's what we were given, really, in the grand scheme of things. Anyway, it didn't go anywhere. Even the Conservatives under Joe Clark said it was too generous. They wanted to cut it back. But in 1982, we had a major milestone in Saskatchewan where we got our rights enshrined in the Constitution. And once your treaty rights were in the Constitution, everything went to court. And everything was going to court. There's been a lot of court cases ever since, and we keep continuing winning them. And we had a group of First Nations begin a court action on treaty land entitlement. And these were called the MOPS bands, M-O-P-S. There's the Muscogee, the Chappaway, Spiapot, and Starblanket. We called them the MOPS bands. And anyway, they began this legal challenge against the government, and the smart money said that they would win. The federal government would lose. And so then the government decided to negotiate. And this was really interesting because I did a documentary on the history of these negotiations. Bill McKnight was former minister of the Mulroney government, and he was also he became the Treaty Commissioner of Saskatchewan. He was also played an important role in getting land for the Muscat Lake Band inside the city of Saskatoon. So Tom Sitton was the Minister of Indian Affairs. And when I did my documentary, I met with Tom Sitton, and I was just chit-chatting with him before I did the interview, and he said, I guess him and Bill McKnight buttonholed Grant Devine at the First Minister's Conference, and they told him, you're not going to win the next election, so you've got to start thinking of your legacy. And I tried to get him to say it on camera, but he wouldn't do it. They basically appealed to Grant Devine to come on side. Grant Devine came on side. Sitton and McKnight were senior ministers. They pushed it forward. So in 1992, we had the TLE framework agreement, which was signed at one scale. And the province of Saskatchewan, by this time, had changed hands to Roy Romano. And Roy Romano had looking at the books, and he had no money whatsoever. He was cutting things back like crazy. And when I talked with Bob Mitchell, who was the Attorney General at the time, he said they were one bit happy about this agreement, because the Tories had made it, but they hadn't spent a nickel. It was left to the next government to carry it out. And so, that's just the nature of government. And so they wanted to wait, and I recall Roland Crowe was the chief at that time. He threatened to flood Regina with chiefs and angry Indians and do another Battleford thing. And Romano, to his credit, backed down and signed the agreement. And so we got, it was basically a $1 billion agreement by the time the dust settled. And I was appointed the chairperson of the TLE trustees on my reserve. And we spent $24 million and bought 50,000 acres of land. Or as I like to say, we bought 500 egg colonies. Well, 100 egg colonies, 10,000 acres. Anyway, but it was an enormous amount of land. We were the biggest landowners in the Battleford area. We still are. We release the land out, and we make money on it every year. And so all around North Battleford, Sweetgrass, Poundmaker, Ardband, and others, a lot of land. All around Regina is a lot of land. The whole map of Saskatchewan has changed considerably because of this. But the one thing that I really liked was, in spite of all the, we've got some pretty good land, urban land, economically we did pretty good. But we had met with the elders earlier, and they'd asked us, could you please get some land of historical importance to us, cultural importance? So we bought some land on the road that leads to Paynton. It was bush pasture. It was bush pasture. We're just going to put horses and cows out there and leave it at that. But it's since become the spiritual area. It's where our culture camp is. It's where we have our sun dances. So that was just serendipity. We didn't really plan that. But we went down to the Cypress Hills and we started hunting around. And we found 10 quarter sections of land just south of Fort Walsh. And we bought that land. It was a crown land. We bought it and turned it over to reserve status. So about 130 years after Chief Little Pine wanted a reserve in the Cypress Hills, we got our reserve in the Cypress Hills. And it meant a great deal to us as a people. And the interesting thing is that the band has sent people down. But we had a problem with the pine beetle. We had to clean up trees and stuff. We've taken people down on hunts because it's a big elk herd in the area. And everybody who comes back just falls in love with the place. And I really believe we have a genetic memory that takes us back to places like this, because this is where we came from. This is where our roots are. When you get on top of the hill where we're at, if you look back behind Fort Walsh, there's a thing called War Bonnet Butte. That's our land. And if you get on top of that and look south, you'll see the Bear Paw Mountains. And so you can just see the whole landscape that our people would have seen 100 years ago or more. So it really brought back a lot of pride to our people. Where people go down there now and hunt and visit, and it connects us to our past like nothing else has done. So in the TLE, our concept of land, the long view, it came into play again, because it takes you about a year or two to bring a piece of land to reserve status. It has to go through a whole bunch of hoops to get through government. It just isn't that simple. So we would meet with a farmer, and we had guys coming to us in their 70s and 80s they had no one to turn the farm over to. And, you know, it's like the old Indian line, take my land, please. And they would come to us and they'd make these deals. We never had to go around like carpetbaggers and, you know, force anybody to sell to us. And we found that we could buy a guy's farm out. We could lease the land out to another farmer and give him the home quarter to live on for the next couple of years. So he could plan for his move into town or whatever he wanted to do. Go to Kelowna, I don't care. Because some of these guys made some pretty decent cash. Anyway, so we would give them this opportunity to plan for their future, live on that land, and we would gradually move over and take it out. So we weren't land speculators, we weren't doing a quick flip, we weren't forcing people off their land. It was based on willing buyer, willing seller, and we worked out the terms of the deal on one at a time. Some people just sold the land and cut for the door as quick as they could. Others would stay there for as long as 5 years. So it was a win. It was our own private kind of way of doing things. Now, where am I here? I guess since the natural resources were transferred to the province in 1930, our people were not involved, and we have there's a position that subsequent leaders have taken that we want resource revenue sharing. And this is like TLE, this is like land claims. It's on the table. Grant Devine says no, he'll never do it, and that's fine by us, because he's not going to be around forever. And somebody will come along, and I'm saying within the next decade, and we will have resource revenue sharing. It's just, like I say, we will win in the long run. It's just a matter of playing that waiting game. And it might not even be our choice. Maybe there's all kinds of court cases. Bill Gallagher, who's written the book Resource Rulers, has, at the time he wrote it about a year ago, there's been 150 cases ruled in favor of First Nations. I think it's 150 to like zero in favor of First Nations and resource rights. And now it's gone over 200 in the intervening period. All very important pieces of legislation that have really rewritten the resource development in this country.